going on, that will be submitted at 3:30 on this very day. In other respect, has been taken place, and the students, they have taken great effort. Now you see, if we look at the map of the world, what we find that if a bed is far and it's studied, and if two countries are checked into one side, India and China, and rest of 200 countries, they are checked on other side, and if the ratio of population is applied, we can find that the part of India and China will become borrowed. Means 30% of the population of the world residing in China, and 25% of the people of the world, the entire world, they are residing in India. So this is quite natural. If the more representative nature of the Security Council of the United Nations is to be considered, it is quite natural that India must become permanent member of the United Nations organization, otherwise it is effective. And if the temporary membership, if they are trustee, and they are being given pardon, if the if such type of situation is going on, this United Nations and its efforts of world peace shall automatically fail. Indians, because they are going to represent the quarter of the population of the world. So there is an immense need that India should immediately become the permanent member of the United Nations Organization. But for that purpose, the education should also start from the Indian people. This is my personal opinion. And our government should strongly plead for that, and the nations of the world should also carefully think, because India is a diverse, even if another part of the population lives there in China, they are not a democratic nation. They are following the autocratic regime. Single party government is going on with the fall of Mao Zedong government. So, this is the situation that we should go ahead. Now you see, on this regard, India is a democratic country, we are following the human rights. There is no point of any autocracy in our long history of democracy. Only a small event of emergency took place in 1977, which I remember. But that was a very small thing. But more on we follow the democratic pattern. In Kashmir also the democratic pattern is going on. Maharaja Singh had already, without permission, signed the instrument of accession in favor of India. So there is no point of any discussion. The only discussion can be done, that is in relation to the part occupied Kashmir. Bilateral relations and all these things. That is also my personal opinion. So now you see, on this regard, this United Nations organization, which is also complaining about the Uday Desh Pandey, the world. This is the largest body, and they should consider what is what is representative of India, current representative of India here, and here demanded that the permanent membership of the United Nations be conferred upon India, and I will agree with her, and with the mark the words, and now you see, I can speak but, in this assembly, telling that the students should not speak like this, okay, because they are representing the other side.
Members and students.
became witness. General sent me to Hebron yesterday. There was a session, and some heads of the state had participated in that. Then some issues, economic issues, health issues, or some issues, health issues, that were discussed in the Economic and Social Council. Today, the Security Council doesn't say some issues are taken, has been delegated for. Veto has been exercised. And you must notice that when a negative vote is cast by a permanent member of the Security Council, the international peace and security is in danger. Take the number very dear to us, we know Pakistan law. In 1971, Pakistan declared war. That was a declaration. 300 declarations of Pakistan in war over India. No doubt, declaration of war is illegal. But there was a declaration. When the war is declared by member state of the United Nations upon another member state of the United Nations, and the United Nations was simply sitting, Security Council could not decide anything. Anytime when the meeting of the Security Council continues 24 hours, all the 7 days, till there is a breach of peace, using war, Europe war, 22 times voting happened, and every time there was a veto. Pakistan was divided into two. War comes to an end. That was simply some awful restriction on the big powers, or some danger of the third world war, but they have not entered into war, either on the side of Pakistan or India. Otherwise, they would have been third war. The purpose of Security Council is basically end to the people. One thing is, it has already happened in 1950. When the Security Council fails to take any action due to veto, then the United Nations could not take any action. One of the causes of failure of these organizations, which was formed after the First World War, was that functions and powers of the Assembly and Council in those days were not divided. Any matter within the jurisdiction of legal nations could be discussed in the Council and also in the Assembly. And there were three occasions when the General Assembly was also discussing that matter and Council was also discussing the same matter. Council decided something else, and Assembly of the Legal Nations decided something else. So that very experience was before when the United Nations was being formed. So they clearly divided the powers of the United Nations General Assembly and Security Council in the UN Charter. Article 12 is there in the Charter. It says that till the Security Council is discussing any matter, General Assembly could not discuss any matter. That is, when a matter is being discussed in the Security Council, because it is the primary function of the Security Council to maintain international peace and security. So when the Security Council is discussing something, they could not take that matter. They could not listen. They could not even deliberate. They could not discuss anything. So that is the reason of our clearly in the Indian Charter. But this matter was also failed in 1950. In 1950, North Korea attacked South Korea. And the Security Council decided two things. One was North Korea has attacked South Korea. Second was the United Nations must come into picture. It must send something, some support to South Korea or to maintain peace. Must do something. So two matters were discussed. But the reason of this decision was that the Soviet Union or Russia Soviet Union was absenting in the Security Council. Just like today, when the Security Council was putting vote, the grand member of the representative of Russia, the bipartite committee. I'm not sitting there, it was absentee. I thought it. The Security Council. So, in the absence of the Soviet Union, Security Council decided to deal to things that North Korea has attacked South Korea. And United Nations must help to maintain international peace and security. Then Soviet Union got an idea that it must go to the Soviet Union. Thus he came back. As a member of Russia, he came back to the meeting. Almost the same. The representative of Soviet Union was sent to the Security Council and he vetoed all authorizations of the Security Council. So nothing could be decided. All the help could be sent, all the peace could be maintained, but two things were unsettled as well. Then the United States, representative of the United States, put an end to the Security Council said what has been done today by the representative who was presiding here today of the United States. That he put an end to the Security Council. Now the Security Council is not in session. And when the Security Council is not discussing anything, matter proceeded to the General Assembly. Then General Assembly took three decisions. Many students of law accept that one of the judges. Any student of political science, but for the three decisions of the General Assembly, they were very much known. Any student of international law, uniting for peace resolution, that is known as uniting seven semester students.
Peace, threat to peace, or act of aggression,
and this theoretical group fails to take any action. That is, any one of these three is to decide first. If an armed attack occurs, all this is meant to peace, all the need of peace. First, this is to be decided, and on this decision, Security Council permanent member may cast a negative vote. So that is the danger. That is the danger where the United Nations stand today. But in that case of Korea, it has already been decided that North Korea has attacked South Korea, and the United Nations must send some forces to maintain international peace and security. That is, the General Assembly decides that if the Security Council has failed, then the General Assembly will amend. General Assembly is only deliberative body. One thing must be clear. They simply deliberate. They simply pass resolution. They can't send any forces to the country. They must come to the member country to send their forces or to help in maintenance of peace and security. They could not say how much money will be sent to the country. So the hands are closed there. But for this resolution, uniting for peace resolution, General Assembly has passed the resolution that General Assembly will recommend. Yes, Anjaniye. General Assembly passed the resolution. Yes, that's the thing. You may say, that's not here. This is not part of the resolution. And this resolution is not a part of the one resolution was passed, that was for the writing of this resolution. So that is very important. It has twisted the whole of the power in the federal system. What was once stated that the General Assembly shall have the primary duty, but it was the only duty of the General Security Council. It was the only duty of the Security Council to maintain the international peace and security. But now the General Assembly has taken over that power by a simple resolution. And that was working of this revolution. If Security Council takes the United Nations, as the General Assembly, may make a recommendation to its members to take action. Second resolution was, and it is because the Security Council deemed to be in session all the 365 days. The representatives, they are sitting there in New York. They may be called for 2 hours to protest. The meeting of the Security Council may be called for 2 hours to protest. But General Assembly is not there in that case. And the second resolution was that an emergency resolution, an emergency session of the General Assembly may be called by 24 hours to notice to all the member states. If Security Council could not take action on any duty which is presently passed before it. So that was the second resolution, emergency session of General Assembly. And third resolution was also passed, and that was member states undertake to comply the recommendation of General Assembly to maintain international peace and security. If the Security Council has failed to take action and General Assembly is taking some action to maintain international peace and security. So these three resolutions of the General Assembly has twisted the power of the United Nations. At any Gandhi. Chapter 7 is peace, definitely right to peace, breach of peace, or right to aggression. In such case, the power to take action has been changed, not from Abram. Step to also to General Assembly. So this is the amendment of the Constitution, the Charter of the United Nations Charter, by the General Assembly itself, that the majority of the United Nations. But all the decisions, all the decisions in the emergency session of the General Assembly is not, they are not by any general vote, but they must take their decisions by two-thirds of majority, not by simple majority. So they must take their decisions by two-thirds of majority. We must understand by this UN of UN sessions. What is the United Nations system? For what it has been constituted and how much it is serving its purpose? I think this we have any question on this. Any question on writing for peace resolution, emergency session, and duty of the states? You believe? Most of this. Then, there has been some calls. And in DIA, because it is our family, we might be still a referent to our different countries. Some students have been presented in the various cases also, Pakistan and Iran. Yesterday, so very thankful to both of you.
Pakistan.
something acceptable to us, but she was very high class, and she was very modest class. She raised the issue of human rights, and that is what violation of this very thing. Human rights and fundamental freedoms, that is also for what this international institution, that is United Nations, was constituted. One of the main objectives, it could be discussed in this session, in general assembly session, it could be discussed. Violation of human rights of certain category of people. That is common. No person, even on the basis of race, sex, or caste, or anything, on the national basis, the issue of fundamental rights, and not fundamental, they are human rights. Because we are all human beings, we have certain rights. And those rights should be protected. And for that very purpose, United Nations has been formed. So there has been a development in that case also. India has also some amendment. We will be discussing in another session all these issues, human rights. Then one more issue for which the government has taken place. Any other problem? Women with seven special students. Any other purpose for which United Nations was formed? Any other purpose? One was to maintain and repression peace, other was to protect human rights and fundamental freedoms, and what was other? So, seven semester students, orders from Supreme Council. In 1956,
which are retained. Not a lot of people.
And after the crisis in position, I would not have the time to thank the organizers, Professor Desh Pandey sir. She has been taking a lot of pain since last event to procure this thing and that thing. I used to say, I will do this, I did actually not say. As in my take. Basically, yesterday in the morning, at 9:15, some chairs, those red and green chairs, they were left by the person that we gave and the function of the ceremony was at 9:30.
Busy again.
She has been.
अभी आपको प्राइस डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन और होगा ना
तो
ये कैंप ना भी यार ये भी अपन जो इम्पोर्टेंट हो रहा है ना
as they arise. Unfortunately, they arise.
I am here in a spirit of gratitude and humility for the trust you have placed in me to serve the Dutch people. Now I declare the session ready.
Honorable Kushal Sharma, representative of Germany. A variety of strategies and policies are used rather than legislation. Shri Sharma, representative of Cuba.
Agreement as to whether it was achieved or not.
But one thing is, must be sure and certain that unions have some effect in global climate and heightened human activities that contribute to the alteration of the face of the earth. Highlighting the natural causes of the climate effect, Pilgrim restating that the external and internal factors could lead to changes in the state of the Earth's climate system. External changes in the state involves effects from the variation and extraterrestrial systems. For example, a change involving the variation in central output, which would externally cause variation in the atmosphere of the solar radiation received by the Earth's surface and atmosphere. Talking about the internal factor, it involves the ocean, atmosphere and land system. For example, international variations could be due to the changes in the concentration of the atmospheric gases, mountain buildings, volcanic activity, and changes in the surface of the atmosphere. A study of the past episode of climate change has found evidence to suggest that only a limited number of factors are primarily responsible for the climate change. Global warming has been generally agreed to be caused by the emission of greenhouse gases, such as carbon dioxide, methane, and nitrous oxide, and also chlorofluorocarbons and other chemicals too, into the atmosphere. The greenhouse effect is a natural effect, which helps to prevent the excess loss of heat and the Earth's surface. Without the effect, the Earth would have been a lot more colder and likely to have been habitable. For humans, animals, and plants, it has been postulated that the Earth's surface could have been almost 33 degrees more colder. The accumulation of these gases in the atmosphere results in heightened greenhouse gas effect, which leads to global warming and attentive animal ages in the local temperature, humidity, wind speed, precipitation, soil moisture, and sea levels. Climate change has also been reported to have a global cooling in some previous eras. And erosion in the An increase in erosion in the atmosphere, also due to the industrial emissions, cools the Earth through a reflection back to the space. If the greenhouse effect continues and then it gets more and more stronger, the more we extract and need it from the Earth, and it might again be less habitable for animals, humans, and plants. The aggravated emission of the greenhouse gases is linked to human efforts towards industrialization. The objective of this paper is therefore to show that humans, in fact, become more and more industrialized, have as well as adversely affected the environment, integrating the climate change. Greenhouse gases from the human activities are the most significant driver of killers the climate change since the mid-20th century. The indicators in this section characterize emissions of the major gas outlets, resulting from human activity, concentration of these gases in the atmosphere, and how emissions are concentrated and have changed over time. By comparing the contribution of these gases, the concept of global warming potential is used to convert the amount of gases in carbon dioxide equivalents. There are six main types of these gases which are involved in greenhouse gas emissions. These are carbon dioxide, nitrous oxide, methane oxide, which is 20 times much more stronger than carbon dioxide and greenhouse gas. Hydrofluorocarbons, chlorofluorocarbons, and sulfur hexafluoride. What we could also have the ability to relate greenhouse effects. So it's also considered greenhouse effect emission as well as non-anthem, nitrogen trifluoride. It is well said that the industrialized countries have a major contribution in global warming. With the increase in the growth of industrialization in developed countries, more and more emissions of pollution from the industries which pollute the air and water bodies of the world. Developed countries like Germany, China, Japan, Russia are about responsible for 79% of the historical carbon emissions. About 98% of the carbon dioxide emission, 24% of the methane gas emission, and 18% of the nitrous oxide gas emissions are due to the fossil fuels burned to run cars, trucks, heat homes, businesses, and power factories. Industrialization emits more and more carbon dioxide and decarbonizations. In fact, because having that in 1997, the United States emitted about 20% of the total global greenhouse gases. Up until 2007, the United States was the world's largest emitter of greenhouse gas. I repeat, the world's largest natural gas emitter. And still, it continues to be the largest emitter of the gas and accounts for 40% of the industrialized country emissions. Due to this much longer period of industrialization, the US has emitted much more than China in the atmosphere. This is a serious situation because greenhouse gases, such as carbon dioxide, linger into the atmosphere for decades. There is a huge contrast between the industrialized nations and poverty in the developed nations, in greenhouse gas emissions, as well as the reason for those emissions. These emissions are not only restricted to the foundations and countries which emit them, but are also adversely affected by the unindustrialized nations. So far, the effect of the industrialization of the Western world are also affected by the developing world of Africa and Asia. These effects are described in terms of opportunities and challenges. The challenges of industrialization include impact on the global warming, higher energy demand, higher education demand, higher industrial waste, exposure to dangerous machinery and equipment, health problems, and etc. These situations have direct impact and effect on the developing countries dealing with climate change. Impact as they are the least able to cope with these consequences. Their vulnerability is due to multiple factors that can limit their capability and respond to the impact of climate change. My country, Cuba, has become the latest country to enshrine the fight against climate change. In order to control climate change and fight against it, we have approved a new constitution that includes amendments directing Cuba to promote the conservation of the environment and fight against climate change, which threatens the environment and survival of the human species. The country joined with 10 other nations, including Equator and Tunisia, that mentioned climate change in their constitutions. Cuba has already introduced aggressive policies to combat global warming, including a long-term plan to adapt more destructive hurricanes, extreme droughts, and sea levels rise fast. Cubans have much to lose if the climate keeps on warming. As the country has already experienced intense droughts, increased sea level rises in the past 50 years. And according to the Cuba Institution of Meteorology in Havana, it says that if the global warming continues, we have not to lose $1 billion of damage. These efforts of the Cuba are part of the 100-year plan. It includes a ban on new construction, the potential of flood zones, the introduction of the heat tolerant crops, sufficient food supplies, and drought and the reconstruction of Cuba's sandy beaches to help protect against the coastal erosion. I must say, not only on behalf of Cuba, but also on behalf of the other undisclosed countries that keep together countries to continue and do not face any significant and absolute restrictions in their emissions, there will be a progressively smaller carbon space available to accommodate the development needs of the developing countries. Summing up, it is clear that the climate changes have more and more impact on the developing countries compared to the developed ones. Industrialized nations need to vigorously pursue programs and strategies that help with emission reduction. Despite the annual international consensus on climate change, that is, the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change, UNFCCC, and Conference of the Parties, COP, so far, there have been only little progress in emission reduction. It is necessary for the industrialized nations to realize that they are actually responsible for the rapid deterioration of our habitat and should therefore make some concentrated efforts towards ameliorating the already bad situation. The natural carbon and human-induced climate change differ in its latter and its capital. This means that the ecosystem has less chances of adapting the changes that will result and serve effect felt will be worse and more dramatic if the things continue the way they are right now. Therefore, more commitment is required from industrialized nations towards reduction of the emissions. Sustainable should be the underlying principle of the value of any industrialization oriented nation. Lastly, I would like to say people must be taught properly sensitized and have the key into the climate change equation, and also that the developed countries must support the developing countries in all solutions related to the climate change impact. Muchas gracias, bienvenido. Thank you so much. Have a good day.
शिष्य गुरु से
Making this event successful. Thank you.